I always took ownership of my results and like I never pointed fingers at anybody on my team or marketing or, you know, pointed at my engineers or clients. Like I never really pointed fingers at anybody. And I think that's what helped succeed there. And then same thing in business too. It's like I took extreme ownership and this was my job. Like this is, I'm going to do it well. And if I'm not doing it well, I'm going to find somebody who can help me do it well.
Who's this? Oh, you're an entrepreneur? Oh, you're a real estate investor? Oh, you're trying to learn from those who did it? Well, come into the lab then. Put your white coat on, gloves on, notepad, and let's build, y'all.
Experiment Nation. Today we're in the lab with a brother that I'm very, very excited to have in the lab with me because of a few things. We talk about practitioners who come in the lab. That's why I got the white lab coat every single time. To appreciate a proof of concept, because in the lab, we don't do anything that, you know, we're not flying by the seat of our pants. We take proven concepts, models, and put them into well-trusted, validated experiments per se. And this is a gentleman who's done just that, but he's taken it to the next level. And when you think of proximity, he's the kind of individual that I want to be in proximity to. And he's done so himself by not only being able to talk the talk, but being able to walk it. And today he's also a leader in our space and leader of a very well-known organization, as you know, that I'm happy to roll out the red carpet to welcome the one and only Mike Reilly into the lab. Mike, man, we are super, super overdue. We planned around, we had a few cancellations, then I came on the pod, and now you're finally here in the lab, and I'm very excited, man, because you're one of those guys, bro. Like, I gotta give you the kudos. You're not like a flashy guy at all. You're just straight to business, so humble. And I think you need to be in the lab so we can hype you up a little bit more, because there's so much that you do. And it's not that it doesn't get unrecognized, but you're so smooth about it that I think it deserves more of an applaud. And so I want to say that to you, that I have that kind of level of respect.
Thank you, brother.
And I want to also level set before, because I want to give you the kudos of you know, and it's so funny because I know all that you do. And before I came on the show, I'm like, dude, by the way, what's the name of your actual like business? Because you're like, you give so much to others that we almost forget. Like, dude, you like did this, and you come from humble background too. So let me level set, and you can fill in some gaps, because I'd love to hear what you say to people when you meet them, right? Or when they meet you. But this is what I have as far as receipts in the lab. You took a proof of concept. You worked at a really nice, you had a great job doing very well for yourself. We actually happen to use that every day. It's our search engine, Google. You worked there, and you and your wife, you know, you just said, hey, we're going to go all in on this. And I know that you, when I think of your market, when I think of people, I always think of them, where are they in the market? From what I know, you're in the Carolinas, right? Mm-hmm. And you're a founder of your B&B property, but you're also as well the head of coaching and ops at STR Secrets. And if anyone knows anything about short-term rental secrets, I think you and I can both appreciate what it's done for us, because you know, we were just on the show together. Mike came in the lab in episode 91, and when he came on and told me that he had retired his wife, himself, and his mother in 18 months, I think people like you and I, we listen. But you listened and you took action very quickly, and you earned the spot to be what I call you. You're Mike's right-hand man. Really, like behind the scenes, it's like, speak to Mike Reilly. I don't know if people know that, but I wanted to give you that shout out, because like, dude,
you're
the man behind the machine, and every great organization like the STR Secrets one has someone like that. And the only way you're able to get in that position is by having the receipts yourself as well. So my question is, man, like if I pull up on you in the airport, I like to travel, and I sit next to you and say, hey, what do you do for a living? What do you say?
Yeah. First thing I say is I'm a real estate investor. At the core, that's what Sierra and I My wife Sierra and I are, and that's how we got to where we're at now. And I love teaching and showing other people how to do what we did too, you know? So yeah, that's typically what I tell people, and I can go far back as you want or as recent as you want, but yeah, man, that's me.
Well, here's what I'm going to do. And here's what I am going to do. I'm going to ask, because I feel like real estate is one thing, right? I think Bigger mm-hmm. Pockets planted that seed for me personally. Mm-hmm. At least that was one of the starting kind of areas. Then Mike planted the STR seed and I watered that plant. And then Dr. Rachel, who's a good friend of mine, planted the MTR seed and I ran away with that. Where was that seed planted? Because I think short-term rentals are very niche, or at least mm-hmm. hospitality has been around for a good amount of time, right? Mm-hmm. But, you know, the way we're doing it, right? You know, even when you talk about co-hosting, let's talk about that. Who planted the seed first, and then what model did you take on and why?
Yeah, for sure. It goes back. So I played tennis in college, and I thought I was going to go professional. You know,
I didn't know that.
Yeah. So
I love tennis.
Yeah.
No, like I play.
Dude, it's an awesome sport.
Okay, I don't know
if it's awesome sport.
Up with you anymore. Damn.
Yeah, I love it. I don't play much anymore. I play a lot of golf now. But that was, dude, I thought I was going to be up there with Rafa Nadal and Federer. Wow. And so it was my junior year at Penn State. This was 2013. I found out, I started having like really bad low back pain. And, and I didn't know what it was from. I went to the chiropractor, went to a couple doctors and found out it was my kidney. And I had a kidney that was working at like 5% and I needed to get it taken out. And so, it was a case of kidney disease that really the kidneys don't regenerate. So once they're at that point, it's like, you might as well get it taken out. So, I finished the season, got it taken out, and I had about 9 months to recover. And, I spent the 9 months literally just sitting on the couch watching tennis. And I was thinking to myself, I was like, so what am I going to do if something like this happens to me again? Like, what would I do for money? You know, cause I got a scholarship and my parents didn't have a lot of money either. And they spent a lot of money on me traveling and playing tennis tournaments when I was in high school and stuff like that, put it on credit cards and helped me through it. But, you know, I bought into the corporate world. So, you know, get into the corporate world. I worked for right out of college. I got a great job working for a tech company that was based in Silicon Valley. They had an office in North Carolina. And so I really bought in and
is there a reason you don't say Google?
Well, no. So that is the first company was NetApp.
Mm-hmm. Okay. NetApp. Okay.
Great company, great people. And my cube mate mm-hmm. from day one was a guy named John Farber. I think you and I have talked about this.
Dude, that's crazy.
Yeah.
Well, I have, but it's blurry because we're kind of, it's like 1 degree of separation at this point.
Right.
Because mm-hmm. I shout out to John Farber. Yeah, he's been on the pod, I believe so, or I've been on his pod. He's been on my pod. Yes. At the time, we realized that we had a connection with like Chris Grenzig. I don't know if you know Chris Grenzig, but he was based out of New York. But anyway, it's such a small world. And then his connection with Elefante, which is kind of, again, keeps getting crazier and crazier. Okay, so you worked with who? His friend?
No, I was cube mates with John. So he and I, we were cold callers. Like we would cold call IT managers to get them to take a meeting with our account executive about data storage. So like, you know, Google Drive basically for big corporations. And so he and I would compete, you know, on a monthly basis and have fun with it too. I mean, you gotta have fun when you're, you know, cold calling guys that don't want to talk to you. So, and we played a lot of golf together and he actually bought a condo. It was like a 3-bedroom condo and I rented from him and, you know, he put like 5% down and did like the house hacking before we even knew what house hacking was.
So you were renting from John?
Oh yeah. We were living together. I was renting a room from him. And so We were roommates, and then he started a podcast. And episode number 5 on his podcast was Mike Shogren. And at that time, you know, I had been listening to a lot of Bigger Pockets. I had a great job. You know, I was making good money, but I knew there was something a little bit more out there. And same thing for my wife, Sierra. She worked for the same company at the time. And then I made the move over to Google a couple years later. But
is that where you met, by the way?
Yeah, we met at work. Yep.
Let's go.
Yeah.
That's yeah. Cool. Man, so wait, first of all, I want to just interject for a second, because I think shout out to the 9 to 5s that got us, like, you know, connections. Cause you know, it's interesting, right? Cause sometimes you'll bash, like, I always tell this to my friends. Like, I met my roommates are my business partners and like best friends. And I say that because they're twins. And I met my wife in school. So when I think of my ROI, like
pretty good.
Like, dude, like school was good, bro. I don't know. I can't hate on it. And so in your case, you can't, you know, if you met your wife 9 to 5, I don't know if you can bash the 9 to 5. You could say it was a season in your, because a lot of people, mm-hmm. I think, naturally do that. I'm like, no, it was like, I think it's a nice stepping stone. So you were in California. You were in the Silicon Valley. You were in California.
No, I was, it was, the company was based there, but they had an office in Raleigh, North Carolina.
Yep. Okay, cool.
Yep.
So you did the whole house renting, you saw John do the house hacking, then mm-hmm. he started a podcast. So there's mm-hmm. a few kind of like over, like crossover things. So what was your conversation with John? Like, was it more like, dude, how'd you do that? Or was it like, oh, I know of this and I kind of want to do the same? Or like, what was that dialogue?
No, not even, man. It really happened a little bit more organically. So mm-hmm. I moved out and moved to Nashville, Tennessee to take a bigger role at the company. And then he moved to New York City to take a bigger role. So we were both like doing our thing. We were both getting promoted. And then that's when he started the podcast, when he was up in New York City. And so he and I would listen to his podcast. He would call me up, and I didn't have anything really to do in real estate at that time. We just kind of would catch up. And then I started listening to his podcast, started listening to Bigger Pockets. Sierra's mom was in real estate, and so she always had a lot of interest in it too. And so her boss at the time and her job, I mean, we were both traveling like ridiculous amounts. I mean, I did for work. I was doing 45,000 miles like a year just for work, traveling, doing like 100 nights in hotels. And I was 26. So, you know, like I was not 25. So I was also taking clients out and like going out at night and drinking and just stuff that wasn't in line with, you know, where I wanted to go. So Sierra and I took a little trip to Brevard, North Carolina, which is just south of Asheville. And we needed to get away from the corporate life for a bit and just really reconnect with each other, because we were engaged at the time, but we weren't really sure kind of what was going on in the corporate world. It was just, we were like living two different lives. So on the ride there, we just randomly listened to a Bigger Pockets podcast from Jay and Wendy Papasan. And so Jay wrote The One Thing with Gary Keller. And then Wendy is an amazing businesswoman and just awesome person. But they did a podcast about couples goal settings and like some questions to ask each other about like all areas of life. So, you know, health, relationships, family, fitness, like all these different areas. And so we went through that exercise together and figured out, like, Sierra, we had to get her out of her job like as quickly as possible, whether it was going like just jumping and going full time into real estate, or we needed to figure out a way to get her out of a situation that was like changing her, like her core values.
Was she in the same line of work?
Line of work. Yep. Same line of work as me and John. And so, you know, we were staying in an Airbnb paying, I don't know, probably $1,800 for a weekend for a little 2-bed, you know, cabin with a hot tub and a nice view. Right. But we're like, what about this Airbnb thing? And so literally a week later, I had listened to the podcast that John Farber did with Mike Shogren. And then I had a call with Mike Shogren and I was like, you know, we connected on the family level and we connected, you know, he left his 9-to-5 and I was like, I want to do that for my wife's, you know, and ended up joining STR Secrets then.
What, dude, this is crazy. Cause as you're talking, I'm thinking about the timelines and areas of kind of where we are all at. We were just talking about this with a buddy of mine. I'm like, just looking back, and it's so funny to be able to think about the different people that you know, same kind of timeline, and like where everybody was at, and how it's beautiful how it all comes together. So that was like, what would you say? Was that like 4 or 5 years ago?
Yeah, so that was February 2020 is when I had that call with Mike. And yeah, 4 years ago.
Isn't that crazy?
Yeah,
that's beautiful. Dude, that's really beautiful. So by the way, like that call, was that because I think it matters for people, because I think sometimes you listen to that and you're like, well, I'm kind of stuck on the action taking, but it sounds like you are the type, and correct me if I'm wrong, like you go, or do you go towards the who, or like what kind of, how do you typically like tackle something new? And yeah, I'm just curious about like your whole mindset. Was it like, yo, John, can you connect me with this guy? Like, what was that process like?
Yeah, John and I had a lot of conversations, and he, you know, I told him, hey, I need to figure out a way we can make more money. And like John had a few properties at the time, and he had interviewed a ton of people on his podcast. So he gave me Brenton, this guy Brenton, who was doing like a bunch of fix and flips up in like the Maryland area. And then he gave me Mike. And these guys have programs. Like 2020, not a lot of people had coaching programs like it is today. Like, so
yeah, crazy, it wasn't how quickly the time goes.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. So, oh, wow.
So yeah, and then had that call with him and really connected with Mike and his like story about Caden and family. And yeah, and just I remember like putting the credit card down to pay for it. And I was like, it's like kind of the most I've ever spent on anything outside of an education, like college. And dude, the ROI I got from like working with Mike versus, you know, college. Yeah.
Yeah. It's all seasons of life for sure. That's how I look at it. You're like exactly it's an experiment, exactly right. A step. And really I think is. As soon as you can recognize that, you it's powerful too. So 100%. Tell me about the first deal. Like, okay, so now you get, you know, you get this, like, I believe in proximity as well. So in your proximity with a guy who's basically done what you want to do, as we know, there's different models. Did you, what was the first model that you and, is it Sierra or Sarah?
Sierra. Yep.
Sierra, you and Sierra kind of decided to tackle.
Yeah. She's, she knows what she wants, which is great, because I'm very macro of like, here's all the options. Like, here's the ultimate goal. And then she was able to narrow it down to be like, I want a mountain house. She loves the mountains. Mm. So that made it easy for us. And so, yeah, we analyzed a bunch of deals. We saw a bunch of properties and ended up closing on our first A-frame in Brevard, North Carolina. It was $260,000, you know, and putting a down payment on that, put 10% down, put a little bit of furnishing into it, basically just wiped out my entire like bank account. It was like probably 40 grand at the time, maybe a little bit less than that. And just said, we're doing it. Like we'll figure it out. And, yes. And Mike really showed me the way, kind of held my hand through it. We underwrote the deal and underwrote that if the property did 53,000 in the first year, it would be a good deal. And ended up it did 101,000 in the first 12 months.
Oh, wow. So hold on. So you got this A-frame. It was still in North Carolina.
Mm-hmm.
And you remember the price point?
Yeah, it's 260.
260. That's not bad.
No. Nope.
At all. That's amazing. And then what I love about it is the all chips in, because I think just the level of commitment and attention, right? Would you say that goes when you just go all in? What would you say to someone who's like, okay, like, I don't know about this. Like, do I really dip my toe in to see the temperature? Do I like, what would you say now if you're like because obviously there's a lot of people that we help through. Do you find that is that a pushback where people are like just scared to dive in? And is there a way that gives them the confidence to continue to go all in? Or is it just like making a decision just to go all in? Like, what advice would you give now for people? And I'm sure you give it a ton now, but what are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, the first thing is like make sure you're in alignment with whoever you're working with. So if it's a spouse or a business partner, make sure there's alignment there. And then in alignment with yourself too, because what's the worst thing that could happen at the end of the day? You know, it's like if it's something that you really want, and you've put your mind to it, you've invested in yourself and your education, and it doesn't have to be a monetary investment. You don't have to go out and invest into a mastermind. But if you're investing the time to educate yourself too, that can be enough to get you that first deal and feel confident enough to do it. But at some point, you're going to have to, the Steve Harvey video about him making that jump, you're going to have to jump at some point. And it's in, like you said, it's all seasons of life. If you really want something, if you want to make change, you got to jump at some point. So whether it's jumping into your first property like I did, or jumping out of the W-2 as well, at some point you're going to have to jump, and that parachute's going to come out. There's going to be people that are around you that can support you. And ultimately that's what I felt I had for that first property.
Yeah. But
I knew I would figure it out, even though I probably had $5,000 left in my bank account after we got the hot tub and everything. And I was like 26, you know, none of my friends were doing this. You know, it was like Farber was the only guy. And then Mike, and I saw a few other people in the mastermind doing it. And I was like, wow, it's working for them. So what's the worst case scenario here?
Yeah.
That's the worst case scenario.
Yeah, for sure. That's fascinating. That whole mindset thing is everything, isn't it? The proximity of others showing you that can be done to check mark. If you're looking back, right, you talked about 53-101, right? 53 ended up being 100,000 in. How did you, what do you think contributed to you doubling what was projected?
Yeah. Well, the first thing, the data wasn't that good from AirDNA. So like AirDNA was not as good back then as it is now, just from the way that they collect data. So that was the first big thing. But the second thing is we just, in that area, and especially in the mountains in 2020, it was just mom and pop, you know, type of furniture. And you know, we cut down a couple of trees to open up the view a little bit. We got the hot tub. Like, we designed it. Sierra designed it really, really well. I didn't design it. I do not do that. So she knew what she wanted for herself, and then got really clear on like who the avatar is. And really for that house, the avatar was Sierra. It was us. Yeah. Seriously. It was want a mountain home that has a view that you can go to and just get away from everything.
That's it, dude. That's very, very interesting. So you use that proof of concept. I'm so curious as to hear about like that. Like, you get the first one. I feel like, I don't know if you agree to this. You believe that the first, cause I don't like to, one thing, Mike, I don't like to ever just take things like, I don't like common beliefs. My wife's always like, Ruben, like, why do you always have to challenge? I'm like, just because I don't know. Like, I like to just think things through and not just take them for what it is. Do you believe that the first deal is actually the hardest? Or did things change? Like, how do you look at it now? And maybe for perspective, you can let us know, like, if you continue to leverage vacation home loans and or did things start to change? And then what does it look like now? So let me just take a step back. Was this deal the hardest one, or is that a myth? Is that some truth to that?
You feel? Definitely was not the hardest, I would say. Definitely was not the hardest. I mean, the most recent one that we did, we spent like 9 months rehabbing it and like pretty much a total gut job. So it was much different. So that was probably the hardest, but it's also the most gratifying too.
There you go. So let's talk about what was the next deal, and then how did you start like to grow the portfolio? Did you use a combination of buying and co-hosting? Did you just did you add? Are you even co-hosting? I don't even think I know.
Yeah. Yeah. So we took some of the profits from that first deal and bought one in August of 2020. So we bought the first one in April, and then we just pocketed the rest, you know, just in our pocket really through the summer. And we bought another property in August of 2020. It was a 4-unit in Sierra's hometown of New Bern, North Carolina. And that's where I live now. And
hold on, Mike. So you mean that same year you went from like April to August, or you waited to the next August?
No, like that same year. So we took the, like the first in May, June, July, we pocketed probably about a little over $20,000 just from the summer from that one property. Okay. And so we took that and we partnered with my mother-in-law and father-in-law, and then bought this 4-unit in New Bern. And so it was 4 long-term rentals, and all we needed to do was turn one of the long-term rentals into a short-term rental, and it would turn into a 25% cash on cash deal. So I was like, yeah, like let's do this. Like, let's buy. It was the same purchase price, $260,000. I had to put 20% down. But I only had to put 10 because obviously half, and got a commercial loan from the bank I worked with. And it was like in 2020, it was a 4.95% interest rate.
Jeez.
But, you know, which is good now, but back then it was a little high,
yeah,
you know, because interest rates were like 3%. Anyways, that one.
That's so funny. I just had that perspective. I was like, and then I was like, wait, you were getting like 3.5, 3.2.
Yeah.
Wow. What a time to be alive. Jeez.
Yeah. So that one, the rent roll was like 25 grand a year. We ended up switching 3 of the units to short/midterm. And
you said 27?
Yeah. The 25 was the rent roll from 20. When we bought it. And then the last 3 years, it's done 77,000, 78,000, and 78,000.
Oh my gosh.
So tripled, you know,
that's
under tripled the income on that place.
Experiment Nation, you've heard the word MTR, midterm rentals, as it is currently a hot topic and hot commodity right now, because again, there has been an increase in short-term rental regulations, and there also has been, let's face it, a slowdown in what we were experiencing a couple years back when it comes to bookings. So with that said, short-term rental operators are looking for alternative solutions to tap into the midterm rental space. However, there is a space, there is a sub-niche of midterm rental insurance that I'm truly excited about, that I want to share with you, that the experience that we've had, the tremendous results we've been able to have, and that's the insurance midterm rental space, which is very different than your traditional midterm rentals. When you think of traditionally midterm rentals, you think of travel nurses. There is a space, midterm rental insurance space, that we've tapped in, where you need to be well connected with insurance and relocation specialists and companies, and understand the right type of asset required for you to be able to help these families. What's really important that stands out the most, which you can get in what I'm about to offer you, is the understanding where to be found by these insurance companies, how to properly manage your calendar so that your listings are optimized so that they can find you, how to actually gain traction and build a relationship with these relocation insurance companies. I've put together an MTR insurance blueprint, that's MMTRR insurance blueprint, to cover these foundations after we've had success landing very large contracts on single family homes that literally 4x what we traditionally make in long-term rentals, and also gives us peace of mind because there's less turnover and 100% occupancy, because these contracts can start anywhere from 30 days to 3 months to 8 months, and range anywhere from, again, we've landed anywhere from $8,000 to $9,000 a month in per month on a single family home property, which our mortgages are typically around the 2400 range, which then gives you a large spread of anywhere from 4 to 6K net on just one property. And this is why it's very hot right now, but people
who haven't been in the lab with individuals like myself, like Jesse Vasquez and Dr. Rachel Gainsborough and Noble Crawford, don't have the foundations and don't know exactly where to start. And therefore, this is why I'm giving you guys a blueprint, the MTRR insurance blueprint. Go to the website, experimentrealestate.com, and get yourself a blueprint to completely change or at least have a plan B if you're a short-term rental operator looking to maximize your occupancy and profitability. We'll see you on the other side.
What's the kind of that town, you know, you said four units. What's the unit mix on those?
They're all 1-1s.
What? Mm-hmm. Get out of here. And what's the, so who's the avatar for that region? I'm not familiar.
So New Bern is it's a very historic small town. It's about 35,000 people that live here. It was the original capital of North Carolina. So it was a colonial capital in North Carolina, which is interesting. It was the first like settled area in North Carolina. So there's a lot of history here. So history buffs will come. But also there's, you know, 35,000 people here. There's not a lot of like doctors, nurses that live here. So I serve for, I've got seven 1-1s that I do the strategy of mid/short-term. So okay. I serve a lot of the hospital, you know, traveling doctors, nurses, physicians, therapists as well. A lot of therapists. And then, you know, in between contracts, I just use Airbnb running out short-term.
My guy, the hybrid way.
Yeah, man.
Isn't that fascinating? So that's all, it always goes back to the fundamentals of location, isn't it? Right.
Mm-hmm.
How do you finish those 1-1s? Do you, because I know in my world, it's like people always ask, like, well, do I need to go crazy or do I? And so when you're running the hybrid model, how do I finish? What is the product? How do I create a hybrid product essentially?
Oh, we designed it just for a short-term rental. Like we did the same thing that we did on the first one. And looking back, I probably wouldn't do anything differently, but. I fell into midterm rentals. I fell into it. Like I heard about this furnish finder thing. You know, as a short-term rental, my 1-1s would do right around like 2,300 a month on average. And I was just like, all right, well, this is great, but I have six turnovers, you know, seven turnovers a month. Mm-hmm. So why don't I try furnish finder? And so I just did some basic math of, you know, here's my net and what it would look like as a short-term rental. Also at the time, we actually moved to New Bern. It was during COVID and we lived like six doors down. So like we were still doing the laundry, like for this place, like for the turnovers. It was a lot of laundry. So
wow, because that's four units, right? So four one bedrooms, four different individuals.
Yep.
Wow.
So we tried, you know, put it up on Furnish Finder for $2,000 a month and it just started renting. And we got some great tenants too that were just amazing people. And our occupancy was 90, still is like 97% across my, you know, all seven units. It's crazy.
So, Mike, this is great stuff, man. Are you saying that that $2,500 overhead is for all four units?
No. So for like one unit, I would make about 2,300 gross revenue on that mm-hmm. unit. Obviously there's cleaning fees and expenses and stuff like that. So, that's why I was like, all right, if I have one stay a month or somebody in there month to month and I charge $2,000, I'm going to profit more than if I short-term rent it and, you know, get 2,400 out of
it. Right, because that's gross, and you have your cleaning fees that you got to factor in. Mm-hmm. That's great. And was that a quad or is that just all?
Yeah, it was a fourplex. Yeah, it was like an old historic home that was turned into just four one bed, one bath units.
Wow. So I really want to highlight the peace of mind too. We don't really talk about ROE, return on, return on peace of mind. So there's a return on investment, and then there's is this actually worth the effort? Mm-hmm. Like is it a couple hundred bucks more worth
like all these turnovers that you're eliminating by doing the MTR. And that's why I was, when I was doing the math, I was trying to like, it's, I think it goes back to the fundamentals of doing math, isn't it? Right? Like doing the math and the return on like, okay, peace of mind, like I'm doing less for just about the same or even more sometimes. Right.
Exactly. Exactly.
Oh my gosh.
I like to, I tell a lot of my clients, like I'm lazy is not the right word, but I say it like I'm lazy. I know what I want and I'm going to like put the least amount of effort to get what I want so I can get a lot of different things. So I find like same thing with Mike. I found like Mike created this path for short-term rentals and created the path to leave the W-2. So instead of me working really hard to figure out how to create that path for myself, I'm just going to go learn from his path. I'm going to learn from some other people's path that did it. And I'm just going to go take some tidbits from them and execute it. I'm not going to recreate the wheel. Why would I?
Yeah.
You know, no, and also 100%. At the same time too, like you mentioned math. I tell a lot of my clients this too. Real estate investing and what wealthy people do is they apply simple math to complex situations.
I love that. Simple. Wow, that's a good one. That's really good.
That's all they do. Like lending, you know, financing, using other people's money. All it is, like sub 2, simple math applied to complex situations. And so the bigger problems, the more complex they are, you can make more money. You just apply the same simple math.
Yes. Yes. I that's so good. I agree with you. Like, and it goes back to the fundamentals of business 101, right? You get paid in proportion to the level of problems that you solve, right? And as you know, that's why I love the insurance thing. And you know what's fascinating too, I've heard you say this too, that you've really tapped into a lot of different midterm rental insurance niches, including insurance yourself, right? For those 1-1s, because I know I always rave about like, you know, go for bigger, but you're like, I have the receipts that show that, all the above. So I love the fact that you have the proof of concept. We want to talk about how you elevated from like furnished finer to even doing some insurance. How did that come about?
Yeah, I mean, it came pretty organically. I've just got a website here that newbernfurnishedrentals.com. Like, so somebody just literally Googled, you know, short-term rental and they found me and, or midterm rental, I think, and they found me and called me up. But yeah, I've got one in there right now that her house got flooded in 2019. Mm-hmm. There's a flood in 2019. A big hurricane came through here. We're on the water, on two different rivers here in New Bern and flooded their entire house. And so they actually lived in it for like 3 years until the insurance company would actually pay out and fix, you know, the stuff that was, it was really just like the crawl space and stuff, but they've been in there for 6 months because the contractor's just super slow and you know, they're paying $2,500 a month, you know, standard rent on that place. Again, it's like $2,000. So, kind of fell into it again, like just like I did for the healthcare side, just kept options open and available and made it work for them. And they got two dogs as well. So like following your strategy, got to allow pets. That's
100%.
It's a non-negotiable.
Non-negotiable. I love that. Perfectly said.
Yep. And they're from Boston. So they're yeah, they're down here, living down here. And
you know, that's amazing.
Loving it. So.
Dude, good for you, man. Tell me about the whole, for someone who's listening, they would say, you know, I mentioned co-hosting. You bought your first one. You then partnered on the second, rightfully so. What I love is like, you didn't even wait on the proof of concept. You're just like, oh no, we don't need a, you see, we kind of like showed our proof of concept and like showed the receipts for like an annual year. You guys are like, no, we, y'all saw what we just did and we're going to run it up again in the next 3 months. Mm-hmm. Y'all in or not, yeah. Which I love. And I think what you said is you also get that confidence from someone else that's done it, where you have this path that's been laid out for you and people see that you've also, you're going down that path as well. So that's fascinating. But then after that, you're thinking, what are we doing? Are we doing math? Because, I mean, you got a good job. Are you focused on Sierra's getting, replacing Sierra's income? Like, what's the thought process? Because I always like to, we talk about these numbers, but behind these numbers and decisions is a real life decisions that need to happen. And I think people, like, you know, can appreciate that more. Like, when we hear Mike's story, when we hear your story, I'm like, dude, the guy worked at a really good place, good job, had everything going. And, but then he got burnt out. Like most of us do. That's like humanizing the experience. Mm-hmm. Can you talk about that? Like, what was then? It's like, okay, you got this fourplex. Where's our mindset at then? Like, where are we at in the journey?
Yeah. We didn't wait very long. So September came around. So we bought the property in September or in August. September came around. We got married here in New Bern. And then we were, Sierra left her job right then and there. Like, we were making probably about $7,000 in profit from those two properties. And, like, you know, she was making a little less than $200,000 a year in her tech job. So, like, nowhere near the amount of money she was making in a tech job. But, like, again, it was not the right fit for her. Like, she did not enjoy it. Her boss was just, you know, it's not like he was a bad person, but just didn't handle the situation, a lot of situations, the right way, in our opinion and our values. So we got her out right then in September, and she started working with her mom on real estate. And it was a weird time too, man. Like, it was during COVID, and still, like, everybody was like, what's the market going to do? Is it going to completely come down, completely crash? But we kept getting those, you know, those notifications on the phone for, you know, nice bookings coming in, and we got addicted to it, man. We really liked seeing it. And so at the end of the year, we bought one more property. So we bought another property in Brevard, and got after it. I had a good bonus check, I think, in like November maybe. And basically took all of that and said, we're buying another one.
Were you commission based? Are you
I was in sales. So it was like 40% base, 60% commission.
That's good. See, one of the things I want to highlight more too is, like, we don't talk about, like, the leverage, like, point of having a good job or having a job that gives you, it's not even good. I don't even think that's it. I think for me, what I believe is you should always have income that is performance based when possible. Because when you start seeing a proof of concept like the one you're seeing, you're like, dude, I'm gonna now outperform because it's a means to an end. And so I think, you know, it's in your best interest to find a job strategically or multiple that can then fund the dream. And, you know, one of my guys that came on the show, shout out to oh my God, what's the name of his book? He's literally, his entire brand is A Side Hustle Millionaire by Tony Watley. He basically built a $1 million business and then exited, right? So I just love that, because I think it just gives it gives real context for anyone who's out there who's like grinding and stuff. It's like, you can literally, when you have an exit strategy, now it puts even more meaning to your work. Would you agree, or did you feel even different or about, like, this concept?
Yeah, no, totally agree. And I had a good foundation, you know.
Yeah.
Like, I did the corporate thing. I saw that was, and that was going well, and it was funding us to buy these properties.
Yeah.
So I had some really good bosses. I had some really poor bosses too. So I could see kind of both sides for me. But I never, like, I always took ownership of my results, and, like, I never pointed fingers at anybody on my team or marketing, or, you know, pointed at my engineers or clients. Like, I never really pointed fingers at anybody. And I think that's what helped succeed there. And then same thing in business too. It's like, I took extreme ownership, and this was my job. Like, this is, I'm going to do it well. And if I'm not doing it well, I'm going to find somebody who can help me do it well.
100%.
100%. Dude, that's sick. So you're essentially bought three properties in 1 year. That last one, what was that last one? Like now you got an A-frame, you got a fourplex 1-1. What is the, where's the mindset going? Like, are we going bigger? Or do we do the same thing? Like, where does the thought process go? You know, because I'm assuming you're a very, it's not even an assumption, as I analyze, you're pretty strategic, but you also follow the path. So what was next on that path of what you should be doing or what's a good asset to invest in?
I was like, let's do the first one again. Can we just like copy paste do the first one again in the mountains? And so that's what we did. We found a, you know, back then, like December 2020, there was no supply. Like there was, nobody was listing their house for sale. It was so dry in terms of the supply on the MLS. So I was grinding. I found this house on forsalebyowner.com, FSBO.com.
No way.
Oh, yeah. Cool. And like the pictures were terrible. So I was like, perfect. But they had a view. It met our criteria. It had to have a view. Mm. It had to have an area for a hot tub and it had to sleep at least 10. And so it checked all 10. Those boxes.
That's a lot of people.
Yeah, just because the first one slept 8 and I was like, well, we're crushing on this one. So if we can fit more people and it's in the same area, let's do it.
Wow. Interesting. How many bedrooms are those?
There's 3 beds.
So you're like got a sofa bed situation.
Mm, yeah. It was a 5 twin beds. It was like one of those bunk beds that had like the trundle and stuff.
Just back in a bit. I was gonna say I love that. Just straight leverage. Okay, cool. So you do FSBO.
Yeah. Yep. Whoa. Found it, put it under contract. Like I called a lady up and she had it listed for like 3 or 4 days. And I asked her, I was like, have you gotten any bites or anything? She was like, no, I've gotten a couple calls from realtors asking if like they can list it for me. And I don't really want to do that. And I said, well, I'll give you an offer like today. And I gave her an offer. She accepted it. And then I drove out to see it. And it was like kind of in an okay area. Not as good as I wanted, but we went through with it. And my dad helped out. There was a little bit of rehab we had to do. So I got to hang out with him for like a month out there in the winter. It was in January 2021. But that started doing really well. And I was out of money after that. It's like, again, kind of out of cash. And so that's where the co-hosting business started.
And was that always on the radar or was that more of like, if you could, it sounds like, was that the next lowest hanging fruit or was it more like, no, I know that we're going to buy 3 and then we're going to co-host, like which came first?
Well, I did another goal setting retreat in for 2021. And I was like, so January 2021, I remember it very well. We were at the house, the new house that we had just bought, Sierra and I, my dad, and we were getting it ready to get it start listed. And Sierra walks into one of the bedrooms and like, she's like crying. She's like bawling crying. And we're kind of on a mountain. So like first thing my mind goes to was she just like drove the car off the mountain. Like the car's gone. That was my first thought is, oh no, like, the car's gone, but she's okay. So I'm okay. And she says, I'm pregnant. And so this is 3 months after we got married. And like, she's crying about this because she thought we were going to wait a year, that sort of thing. And I was so happy, man. Like, I remember that moment just like it was yesterday, her coming in that room crying. And just so that was a really, really cool moment for us. I was so glad the car was not down the mountain.
that's okay.
And I was even happier that we were going to have our first child. So,
was there concern in Sierra? Is that what it was?
Like, it was just like a lot of things going on at once. Yeah. And like, she thought I was going to be upset because we had said, hey, let's wait a year, you know? But like, I knew that we weren't going to do that. Like it's the best thing in my life for sure. So then I was like, all right, I'm leaving my W-2. Like
dude, I love how you think, Mike. Hold up, I want to unpack because I want to follow your thought process. Your thought is, I'm having a kid on the way, and therefore now I got to go balls to the wall. Like, what's the thought like that you're thinking? Why leave the W-2 when someone else might hear that and be like, oh, I must now secure this even more? Like, what's your thought? I want to always say, teach me how to think, not what to think.
Yeah. I didn't love what I was doing, you know, work, but I loved working with Mike and like getting mentored by him. And I remember I was at that house. I was on a Zoom call with him and he asked me, you know, if you had all the money in the world, what would you be doing? And really challenged me to answer that question. I had to think about it a lot. And my reaction was, I would just be helping people. Like, that's all I would be doing, is I would just be helping people. And so that's when my mind kind of shifted to, I can do that. Like, I can have that. And so I don't need to be traveling, you know, 45,000 miles for a job when I can invest in real estate, or I can start a co-hosting business that can generate me income that doesn't take a lot of my time. And I can help Sierra with the baby. I can do a big brother, big sister, which is what we were doing at the time. I can help other people. I didn't know what I was going to help people with, like sales skills, maybe help people find jobs after college, that sort of thing. But then I needed money. So that's why I started the co-hosting business, to generate income for Sierra and I, so that I could eventually leave the W-2 at Google.
Yeah, dude. So you strike me as valuing time, like, for sure, right? Like, over.
I told you I was lazy, man.
Well, you know, it's interesting because it always goes back to the opportunity cost, right? And so, I think we sometimes, and I'm curious to hear what you have to say to this, right? Do you think that sometimes we overlook the money and opportunity cost that it takes to get the money, right? The times you're not spending your time here, because, you know, I heard you say, like, spent quality time with my dad, quality time with my, you know, my children, your wife, etc. Shout out to Sierra. So talk to me and us, the listeners, about how you value your time. Is it also the opportunity cost of time that you're factoring in as well? Like, I'm curious, how do you look at that?
There's two things on that. First is, you can always make more money. You can't get more time, like, and you can't get time back. So that's always at the top of my mind, is always make more money. But am I present in this time right now? Because I don't, an hour from now, I could not be here. A day from now, I could not be here. So am I present right now here in this time that I have? That's really the first thing. The second thing, and I learned this from Mike as well, is, you know, look at how much money that you need to live. And you don't really need that much, but it's more about making decisions based on what you want. So since if there's somebody out there that wants to buy a short-term rental, or wants to have a nice car, or wants to have a bigger home for their family, or wants to have a vacation home, you look at how much money you need for that. So in my case, I wanted to leave my W-2. I wanted to leave my W-2 job, but I also wanted to work 3 to 4 hours a week on my business. So $20,000 a month is what I needed. And so if I was working 4 hours a week, that's 16 hours a month. So if I just do again, $20,000 a month divided by 16 hours, that's $12,000. That's $1,200 an hour is what my time's worth.
That's some good math right there. I haven't heard of that one in a minute. That's a good one, right? Because it's what I like about that formula, and this is why I'm in the lab here taking notes, is you're factoring in the time spent to make that money and time spent not making the money. So you, therefore, you have a higher return on your life. Literally, yeah. That's what people talk about, return, like, on investment and et cetera, or opportunity. I love how you said it. It's not like, time is not money. Your life is, right? Time is your life. Which is a reframe that I've recently had, right? As well, is it's about your life. And so that's why I love how Martin Golden says this. I'm a big fan of him. He says how to someone who exchanges their time for money, everything is expensive because your life is expensive. Isn't that fascinating?
Yeah. And once I like made that realization, I was like, all right. So if I'm $1,250 now, I'm $1,250 an hour. Any task that I'm doing that's under that, I shouldn't be doing, you know, and I should be thinking bigger about what are these, like, what's my time worth, especially with like Sierra and I love to go on hikes and walks. And that's a 12,000, you know, a $1,200 an hour task. Like I wouldn't trade $1,000 for that hour walking with her. And so making decisions based on that, you know, instead of playing with the lower properties or like, you know, playing lowballing stuff, I would figure out a way. All right. Is this hour worth $1,250 and start, you know, it can be a double-edged sword. You don't want to trade time for money and like really obsess over that. But if you start making decisions on, your time is worth, then you start hanging around some different people. You start making some different decisions.
Yeah. We always talk about that. Raise the standard, right? What is your standard? Dude, so I want to, you know, because I could go on, but I didn't even, we got on such great topics that are probably even more important than the mechanical, right, of the strategy, etc. But I do want to leave the listeners with some strategy. So finishing with, you're at a point where you invested in your first, partnered on your second, invest in your third. Now you're at a place where, okay, we got a baby on the way, right? Balls to the wall. We're going all in. What is that strategy with little capital now that it's been invested in and maybe you're not touching that yet? What is that co-hosting strategy for someone who's not familiar, and how did you run away with it, and what does that look like?
Yeah, so we had the skill of running a short-term rental like efficiently, and we got that from Mike, but also from experience. And just, we hosted, you know, probably about 100 people at that time, and so we said, hey, well, we can manage and co-host for other people. I saw other people on the mastermind doing it too, and I said, why not us, right? So I started networking my tail off. Anybody, you know, that owned property, I went to meetups. I would, you know, reach out to people, just kind of randomly ask them, you know, hey, you ever invested in real estate, that sort of thing. My first co-host deal, I mean, we could probably talk for another hour, but my first co-host deal came from another friend in the industry, Mike Elefante. So when we were living in Nashville,
it's crazy.
Mike was in tech sales too. And so he,
same company?
Nope. Different company. We didn't know each other, but we kind of knew of each other. And I friended him on LinkedIn, and I saw he changed, talk about identity change. He changed his, title or whatever for on LinkedIn to real estate investor. And this is when he bought his first property in Nashville. And so I cold DM'd him and I said, hey, you know, seems like we're in the same, we're in the same industry. We know some of the same people, like, you want to meet up?
Wait, was this on LinkedIn?
This is on LinkedIn. Yeah.
That's when that still worked, right? Exactly. We seem like we're in the same industry. I'm like, yeah, no shit. That's awesome. I'm so glad that like, talk about being an early adopter.
Yeah, and I was always on LinkedIn too. Back when I was working at Google, I was always on LinkedIn. Yeah. I don't know why. I mean, it's just networking, right?
But well, LinkedIn's legit. Yeah.
We got tacos and just like a blind date pretty much. And then we just became really good friends. Wives became really good friends. And so he obviously reached financial freedom through short-term rentals as well. And he had a friend that a friend of his wife, Jill, had called them and said, hey, do you want to manage my property in Sugar Mountain, North Carolina? Mm-hmm. And Mike and Jill at the time, they were like, no, we don't really want to manage, you know, for other people, but I think my buddy Mike does, Mike Reilly. And so I got on the phone with the referral and closed them and took over from Vacasa and still manage his property today. His cabin crushes it. And so that was like the beginning, you know, through a network, the beginning of co-hosting. And then second deal we got a couple months after that, it was my neighbor that had just bought the home in Brevard that was two doors down from me. Mm-hmm. And I dropped off a six pack of beer at his house and just said, welcome to the street, welcome to the neighborhood. And he calls me, mm-hmm. and we start chatting, and he says, hey, by the way, like, do you know any short-term rental, like, property managers, like co-hosts? And I was like, oh, like, actually, yeah, I do.
Me.
So, yeah. So I helped him out and still manage his property today. And then just momentum kicked in from there. And now we manage 17 units across six different markets in North Carolina.
Wow. Good for you.
It's been a fun business. I got two people that work for me, two great guys that are based in the Philippines that have been with me since 2021, and they help me run most of the operations, and we just go add properties.
Dude, I love your story because it's, first of all, the best is yet to come, and I feel like I'm still reading chapter one. No, seriously, dude, like, you did, like, a lot of, when I look at into it, you realize, like, it's not a very long time, dude. Like, these are just roots that are still building, and what happens is that domino effect of exponential growth, and like your brand, right, just starts to expand, and referrals, etc. So it's just fascinating to see how execution with a proof of concept done quickly, strategically, and effectively can get the receipts that you're able to share with us today and be in the position that you're in. Because like I said, you're a very humble guy, and I don't think you get enough credit and praise on all the amazing things that you're doing too, bro, behind the scenes. I know, bro, like, there's a lot of magic that happens. So shout out to the STR Secrets community that you're really behind the scenes spearheading as a partner with Mike too, in addition to being able to be the dad that I know that you are, and the husband. And dude, I'm just proud of you, man. Like, I can't wait. I can't wait for part two, part three. We're gonna continue that's right, to man. Do this, man. So
that's right.
I know. I went over. What's up, brother?
We got a lot of people to help.
We have some people, a lot of people to serve. And I think that's why, you know, I resonate a lot with you, man. And you're a breath of fresh air, bro. But tell me, what's next on the, like I said, you and I could kick it like this in the lab for a long time, and I know I'm over at the top of the hour here, so tell me real quick, brother, what's the vision, what's next for the Reillys, right? What you got in vision? And I want to ask you personally, because you always focus on other people and serving, but I think it's important for me to ask you directly, because those who serve also need to be served. So what's up, brother?
Yeah,
what is it, you know, what do you want to accomplish? What more do you want to do? What more do you want to double down on? Or what area do you want to explore and experiment with that you haven't experimented with yet?
Yeah, for sure. So, you know, once I left Google, I had some time on my hands, because mm-hmm. I had two guys, you know, really running the show. So I joined Mike at STR Secrets and head of coaching and operations, like you mentioned. And I set that goal in early 2021. Like, I just want to help people. And now that's what I get to do all day, you know, and hang out with the kiddos too, and have a good balance, a really good integration there. So mm-hmm. that's growing STR Secrets and helping 1,000 people this year grow their short-term rental business. That's my main mission, and work with Mike and you and Adam and E and everybody. That's my main mission. Now I'm still investing too. I'm looking at deals every day. Still co-hosting business. I'd I'm going to get a hotel this year.
I was just gonna get it out here on live. He said it, y'all.
Yep, it's out there. It's out there. So anywhere, you know, within 45 minutes of New England. So anywhere along the North Carolina coast, if any listeners know of any hotels that are out there between like 5 and 25 units, hit me up. I definitely want to take a look at them. I think there's a really big market down here that is underserved, and some hotels that really need to be revamped. And you know, one other piece, and I'm going to put this out there too, because I haven't given this enough time and effort myself, and I need to hold myself more accountable. But I think there's a huge opportunity to help more folks that have disabilities or inabilities to be able to vacation, especially at the beach. You know, you think about like my cousin, for instance, she's in a wheelchair. She always has been, and she's cognitively there 100%, but she physically has some disabilities, and she's not able to go walk on the beach, or she doesn't have a beach house, you know? And so like making houses and vacation rentals more ADA accessible is something that is really, I've been thinking about a lot. I just need to take action on it, man, because that could have just helped a ton of people. Young people, old people, like everybody, just make it more accessible for people to enjoy vacations.
Dude, I got to connect you with Dr. Ifoma Naji. I literally had her on my podcast, like probably not more than a dozen episodes ago. And she's a doctor that has a prosthetic leg. Yep. And she was telling me about her experience of being let down over and over again after she would call places. She'd be like, hey, I just want to like confirm that this is it. And people, like one of the paradigms that she opened to me is like, not all physical disabilities are created equal. Like if you have a wheelchair versus crutches versus like, there's a lot of different nuances to that. And her goal is to help cater to that, to solve her own problem too, which I thought is beautiful. So I can stress that enough. We got to take care of all of our people. And at least I know that's the one of the things we look at too for multiple different entrances and all the houses we buy. There's an area that has to not have either a big lip or like no stairs at the front of the house. And, you know, that alone can solve a lot of problems, even at the midterm rental level as well. Walk-in showers, grab bars, like there's a lot of things that is sometimes overlooked in our industry. So again, I'm not surprised that a guy like you who wants to help people, who has such a big heart and who's invested in the people, is also thinking of that. So that's how you put a bow on it, brother. So Mike, Mr. Reilly, my goodness,
I know where to find you.
That's for sure. You're always there. But how can someone just who wants to, like, you know, who connects with the energy that you bring, where's the best place? Are you still creeping around LinkedIn?
No, not as much. Yeah, you can hit me up on LinkedIn. It may take me a couple of weeks, but yeah, Instagram, Facebook, Twitter at Mike Reilly NC, Reilly. That's how the good Irishmen spell it. So
that's the origin.
Yeah,
that's well, listen, man, you're a good soul, man. Lots of respect for you, brother. And likewise, I want to thank you for coming to the lab. I knew it was definitely worth the wait for sure. So Experiment Nation,
thanks Mike for having here. Me.
Mike Reilly at Mike Reilly NC. Make sure you give him a follow. He's a stud in our space and a leader. Salute, brother. Just like that, we are out.
Experiment Nation, podcasting has changed the way we operate as real estate investors ourselves, and it can do the same for you. Podcasting has been the source of the masterclasses that we get thanks to the world-class real estate investors and practitioners and specialists that come into the lab from all realms, from short-term rentals to midterm rentals to real estate syndications to even software as a service. Owners, founders, entrepreneurs have helped enrich our experiments by giving us the education, helping us build a network, and lastly, and most importantly, a brand association to open up multiple doors for our respective businesses. If you understand the power that podcasting can have and you know that you need one for your brand, please, you can rely on our team investedtalent.com is my team and the team that helps this podcast, the Real Estate Experiment, become the fruition each and every single week to educate my community, build relationships on the air, and continue to build our brand. If you know that you need to do the same for your brand and you haven't pulled the trigger yet, maybe because you don't know how, our company, investedtalent.com, does the end-to-end from the time that you record, from the time that it is published, to even repurposing content on multiple social media platforms. That's what my team can do for you. Simply go to investedtalent.com and book a discovery call to see how my team can help you launch your podcast.